So, good afternoon, everybody. It's a pleasure to see this room very full, and it's a pleasure for me to introduce to you Fabiola Gianotti, that is a personal friend. Dr. Gianotti grew up scientifically in Milano, where she got her PhD in 89. Since 94, she's a CERN staff, and today she's a CERN research staff at the highest grade of the laboratory. And she participated to the UA2 experiment at the SPS, the Aleph experiment at LEP, and she contributed to the design, construction, commissioning of the ATLAS experiment at the LHC. She was spokesperson of the ATLAS collaboration at the time of discovery of the Higgs boson. Because of her scientific merits, she is a recipient of numerous awards. I will say only the one that for us, I mean, for me, I like very much. She is Cavaliere of the Repubblica Italiana that she got from Giorgio Napolitano. And she is a public renowned person. The Time magazine ranked her number 5 in the list of the persons of the year 2012. That is really a great achievement. And most of all, she has remarkable human qualities. And she's very good in sharing her personal success with the large scientific community that she represents. Fabiola.
Thank you. Thank you, Gigi, for this very nice introduction. It's a pleasure to be here and very honored to be in this very prestigious school, and I must say that giving a talk in such a spectacular room, I think it's the first time in my life to be in a so beautiful place to talk about physics. So I think everybody knows what the Higgs boson is, and I thought that I would try to discuss today what is behind this discovery. So what are the foundations of this discovery, the work that has been done in order to achieve this important step forward in our understanding of fundamental physics and therefore also the structure and evolution of the universe, and also what are the implications of this discovery for our day-by-day life, but also in general, most importantly, for physics. So I know that the audience is quite a mixed audience with people from physics background, but also people with a different background. So my seminar will be a little bit mixture of quite simple things for which I apologize to the expert, and from time to time I will become a bit more technical, and for this I apologize those who perhaps cannot follow, but I will try to be as clear as possible. So the Higgs boson has been discovered at the Large Hadron Collider, and as everybody knows, the Large Hadron Collider is the most powerful accelerator built by mankind, and it's located at CERN. So I have a couple of slides to tell you what CERN is, because CERN is a very special place. It's the biggest laboratory in the world for particle physics. It was founded at the beginning of the 50s, and therefore, over the last 60 years, scientists from all over the world have been doing fundamental research awarded by important discovery. The Higgs boson, of course, is one of them, but it's not the only one. And Nobel Prizes, for instance, Carlo Rubbia, to mention an example in Italy, and particularly close to our hearts. It's a place where the scientific... can you hear me well? Okay. It's a place where the scientific goals require the developments of cutting-edge technologies in many sectors. We will see some examples later on. Technologies that, of course, we also transfer to society. A very famous example is the World Wide Web, which, by the way, turned 20s in 30th of April. So the World Wide Web was introduced by this gentleman, Tim Berners-Lee, who was a member of the IT division at CERN, and introduced the web as a way for facilitating the exchange of information about among the physicists involved in the CERN experiments, and then of course since then it has changed the way society accesses information. It's also CERN is also a place where we train young people, tomorrow scientists, but also high school and university students, and also school teachers, through a large number of initiatives, and is a fantastic place to bring nations together by attracting 10,000 scientists from more than 60 countries. I mentioned that CERN was founded in the early 50s thanks to the vision of some politician and some scientists, among which Niels Bohr, who is the father, the atom's father, in Italy, Edoardo Amaldi, of course, we cannot forget about Edoardo and his important contribution to CERN. CERN was founded with a twofold goal. The first one was to give back prestige to European research after the war, and the second one was to mitigate the tensions of the Cold War by bringing together European nations to work on a peaceful project like science, fundamental science, could be. Today, CERN is a global laboratory. The member states are 20, and all of them are from Europe at the moment, although CERN is opening its frontiers to member states from outside Europe. But also, of course, the scientists participating in CERN activities come from all over the world. The yearly budget is around 1 billion Swiss franc, which is contributed by the member state countries in a proportion to their income. So, for instance, Italy contributes 11%, is the fourth country after Germany, France, and the UK, which corresponds to about 80 million euros, so one cappuccino per abitante, if you want. Of course, Italy also, as all other European countries, has some return from the investment into CERN, in CERN budget, typically 10%, so for every euro we get back 1.1 euro. But in the period of the construction of LHC, the return was much higher through industrial participation, high-level, high-technology industrial participation to the construction of the accelerator. And I will come back to this later on. So this is the map showing the scientists who work at CERN. So the budget, this 1 billion Swiss francs, is used typically, 50% is used to pay the salaries of CERN staff. And the rest is used to develop the infrastructure, mainly the accelerator, which are used by the worldwide community to do experiments at CERN. And the worldwide community is really worldwide. You can see from this map people coming from all over the world, from Europe in blue, from observer states in green, from other states in red. And clearly the participation in CERN activity has boosted the development, technological development in some countries that have been for many years at the periphery of technology and science. Apart from this sociological consideration, which still are quite important, and we'll come back to this later on, CERN's primary mission is and remains science. So what do we do at CERN is to study the elementary particles, among which we can include the building blocks of matters, electrons and quarks, and their forces at the most fundamental level. So everyone knows, but just to remind you briefly, that matter is made of atoms. Atoms are made of a central nucleus surrounded by a cloud of electrons. And the nuclei are made of protons and neutrons, and the protons and neutrons are made in turn of smaller entities called quarks, which are glued together in the proton and neutron by other particles called gluons. As far as we know today, quarks and electrons are elementary particles, so they cannot be, means they cannot be cut into smaller pieces. And they are the fundamental constituent of matter. So everything in this room, so you, me, and this stick, this microphone, everything is made of quarks and electrons, and a lot of empty space, because the radius of the atom is very big compared to the nucleus. So particle physics at modern accelerators, in particular the LHC, allow us to scrutinize, to probe, study matter at the level of quarks, so at the level of down to scales of 10 to the minus 18 meters, so 1 billionth of a billionth of a meter. So these accelerators can be seen as very powerful microscope, which allows us to study not cells or molecules, but to study the elementary, the fundamental constituent of matters like the quark. At the same time, these studies give us also indication about the structure and evolution of the universe in a complementary way to other approaches like astroparticle physics, space mission, etc. And the reason, so the very small allow us to understand the very big. And the reason is that we know today from cosmology and several experimental observations that the universe had origin from a big explosion called the Big Bang. At the beginning of its history, the universe was extremely hot, dense, and it was essentially a gas of free particles. And then with time, it cooled down, and so particles started to stick together to form neutrons and protons, and then the atoms of the light elements, and then later on the macrostructure that we know today, galaxies, planets, etc. But at the beginning, the universe was really behaving like an ensemble of elementary particles. So by studying the elementary particles, we can understand what kind of interactions and phenomena have characterized the early universe. So what do we do in practice in order to do this kind of study? So what we do is to use, in modern accelerator, we use beams of particles, for instance, protons, like in the LHC, two beams of protons. We accelerate them at high energy, and we smash them. And in this collision, essentially, we study three main things. So my description here is not going to be extremely rigorous. It's not going to be rigorous at all. So I would like to ask my colleagues physicists to fall asleep for a few minutes before until I resume to a more reasonable discussion. So you can imagine what happens in this collision. So first of all, the first thing is that you can imagine that in these big collisions, the protons goes into 1,000 pieces. It's not true, but anyway, just to give you a pictorial view. So then we can study the elementary constituents of the protons, the quarks, and see how they interact at high energy, which kind of forces the exchange, their interaction, their several phenomena related to that. This is goal number one. Goal number two, from the energy produced in the collision, new particles can be created. We all know that Einstein told us that energy and matter are two different manifestations of the same entity. So the energy of the collision can materialize itself and become new particles. And the higher the energy of the collisions, of course, the heavier the particles that can be produced. So particles that could not be produced at previous accelerator because too heavy to be produced, at least at a high rate, can be produced today, for instance, at the LHC. And this is what happened at the Higgs boson, which is not very heavy, it's quite relatively light. However, it's a rare phenomenon, and so could not be produced abundantly enough at the previous accelerator to claim a discovery. So this is goal number two, produce new particles if they exist. And goal number three is what I mentioned before. The energy of the collision corresponds to the temperature that the universe had in the very early instance of its life. And typically, the energy we produced in this accelerator corresponds to the temperature that the universe had 10 to the minus 11 seconds after the Big Bang. So 100 of a billion of a second after the Big Bang. So we are able to go back in time to, in some sense, understand what happens in the universe very early after the Big Bang. So this is what happens in a collision. Now, to study the collision, to detect what the protons have produced in this in their interaction, we use high technology and very massive instruments, which are called particle detectors, with which we surround the collision points, covering almost the full solid angles. And these detectors are used to detect and measure the collision products, ideally all of them, in practice not all of them, but most of them. And this allows us to understand what happened in the collision event. So essentially, we need, in addition to human brains, of course, and physicists, engineers, and technicians, we need, from the instrumental point of view, we need three things. We need accelerators, we need detectors, and we need computers. So accelerators are usually installed in underground rings. So for instance, this is a view of the LHC tunnel, which is a 27-kilometer ring. And what you see here in these blue tubes, these are very powerful superconducting magnets. Accelerators are made essentially by, of two elements, electric field and magnetic field. Electric field are used to accelerate particles, so there's essentially a potential difference, and the charged particles get accelerated going through this this voltage drop or increase incrementally at each turn. So every turn, a particle gets a kink until it reaches the top level energy. The other elements are magnetic fields, powerful magnets, which allow to guide and to steer the beams, to keep them inside the accelerator and to bring them into collisions. Detectors are massive high technology devices with which we surround the collision points, covering, as I said, almost the full solid angle, which allow us, ideally, to reconstruct every single particle produced in the collision. It's not really the case, but most of the particles are reconstructed, at least those produced centrally. And this means not only reconstruct their trajectory with very high precision, but also to measure the energy of the particles, to identify them, so be able to see, to say if it is an electron, a photon, a proton, etc. And so at the end, we have a full picture of the collision, a full reconstruction of the collision event. And then we can move to the interpretation phase to understand if it was, I don't know, the production of a new particle or something that we know already. And then, of course, we need very massive computer infrastructure in order to store, distribute, and analyze the huge amount of data that these monster detectors produced. And I will give you an example. So the most advanced and powerful accelerator detectors and computing infrastructure of the history of particle physics have been developed in the framework of the Large Hadron Collider, which is actually one of the most ambitious projects in science and, I would say, one of the most ambitious adventures of mankind more in general. It has required the introduction of new concepts, new technologies in various fields, from cryogenics to material science to superconductivity, electronics, instrumentation, data transfer and treatment, and more than 20 years of effort of the international particle physics community. First discussions about the LHC took place in the mid-80s, and first collisions took place at the end of the year 2009. So clearly a very long path. So, the LHC is a 27-kilometer accelerator contained in an underground ring at the border between Switzerland and France. So, this is a view, an aerial view of the region. So, this is the border between Switzerland here and France. These little dots, white dots, indicate the border. This is Geneva Airport. Here, the main site of the CERN laboratory with the main offices and buildings. Lake Geneva is down here, and this circle indicate the position of the LHC ring, which is, of course, not visible on the surface. It's 100 meters underground, 27 kilometers long. And over the last 3 years, we have been circulating two very intense beam of protons in the two opposite directions, accelerating them to very high energy. The energy of the beam was 4 TeV, up to 4 TeV, 4 tera electron volts, so energy in the collision 8 TeV. I will come back to this in the next slide, which is a factor of 4 larger than the previous most powerful collider. And the previous most powerful collider was the Tevatron proton-antiproton collider at Fermilab in the US. So a jump by a factor of 4 in terms of energy. These beams have been colliding at 4 points of the accelerator, indicated by these 4 yellow stars, where we had installed inside a very big underground cavern 4 very big detectors, ATLAS and CMS, the two biggest ones, those who have reported the discovery of the Higgs boson, called so-called general purpose, because they've been built in order to be able to study any phenomenon that nature may have put aside for us at the new energy scale provided by the LHC. And then two smaller but not less important experiments, LHCb and ALICE, which are dedicated to some specific physics studies, which I don't have the time to discuss, but we can come back in case of question. Now, Italy, in particular with INFN, Istituto Nazionale di Fisica Nucleare, and the Associated University, has really made very important, crucial contributions to the construction of the accelerator and three of the four experiments, and in particular, also now is contributing in an important way to the physics exploitation of the data, and many Italian physicists, in particular young physicists, I would like to stress, have contributed in an important way to the discovery of the Higgs boson. Pisa, in particular, NFN, sezione NFN di Pisa and the university is involved in three of the four experiments, so ATLAS, CMS, and LHC. As I mentioned before, over the three past years we've been operating, so first collision at high energy, at unprecedented energy, took place in April 2010, and a few weeks ago we have completed the first data-taking period, and at the moment the accelerator is in a period of shutdown in order to improve its, to bring some improvement and repairs and to allow it to reach the design energy, which is 14 TV. Today we are at 8 TV. So I mentioned that the three components of this project are: we need accelerators, we need detectors, and we need computers. So I have here one slide or a couple of slides for each one of these important elements. So let's start with the accelerator. So what is difficult in a proton collider is not to accelerate the protons. This is relatively easy. What is difficult is to keep them, guide them, and keep them confined inside a ring, which is big ring, big circumference, 27 kilometers, but of course this is what limits the energy of the beam, the bending power that you have to use in order to keep the beams inside the ring and then bring them to collision. So when we started to discuss about the LHC, the maximum magnetic field achievable on a large scale, that is building magnets able to fill with a 70% packing factor an accelerator ring of 27 kilometers, which requires industrial construction of magnets, the maximum magnetic field was around 8 Tesla. And so this actually determined the maximum energy of the LHC beam, because the ring existed already, which was the 27 kilometer ring built for the previous CERN accelerator, the LEP collider. So red R is fixed, is 4 kilometer. B maximum is 8 Tesla. And if you put these numbers in this equation and keep into account, keep in mind that you can't fill the full accelerator with bending magnets, you have to put other elements, so the packing factor is 70%, you find that the maximum energy that you can achieve given the present technology in this accelerator is 7 TV per beam. This has required the development of a set of 1,200 superconducting magnets of really unprecedented technology. Superconducting because to achieve such a high magnetic field, you need high currents, 12.5 kiloamperes in this magnets. So they are made of about 8,000 kilometers of niobium titanium superconducting cable, which is one of the most widely used superconducting material. They have to work at very low temperature because superconductivity comes into play when you are below a Curie temperature, below a given threshold. And actually, the LHC is operated at 1.9 Kelvin. 1.9 Kelvin means 1.9 degrees from the absolute zero, so minus 272 degrees Celsius, which is the temperature of the superfluid helium. In principle, we could have operated this machine, this accelerator, at 4 Kelvin, which is the temperature of liquid helium, but superfluid helium, which is a very, very, very special quantum state of helium, superfluid helium, has the characteristic of being of amplifying the superconducting properties of this superconductor, but also to be an excellent heat exchanger. So if there is any kind of heat which develops itself somewhere in the accelerator, it gets immediately distributed, and so this machine is essentially a 27-kilometer bath of superfluid helium at 1.9 Kelvin and superconducting magnet. It was the same. The machine is at 1.9 Kelvin. So these superconducting high-tech magnets have been built in proportion of one-third by three leading European industries, Alstom in France, Babcock Merlin in Germany, and Ansaldo in Italy. So our industry has participated in an important way to high technology developments and construction for the LHC. So, Augusto was mentioning the accident. I mentioned that we are now in shutdown, and the reason is the following. The design energy, collision energy, is 14 TV. Until now, we have been operating at 8 TV. Why? Because you may remember that in September 2008, we had an accident just a few days after switching the accelerator on. There was a problem, which is the following. These superconducting magnets are connected by thousands of interconnection joints. Part of them are superconducting, part of them are that copper, normal joints and connections, and one of them failed, and this produced, broke essentially, and so this produced a release of helium, gas helium in the tunnel, and damages to several magnets. So it took 1 year, essentially caused 1 year delay of the LHC, but also after inspection of all the thousands and thousands of interconnection, it was discovered that some of them were not, although not being so dramatically wrong as the one that that broke, were in any case a bit fragile, and so it was decided to remain at a lower temperature in order to be confident that no other accident would occur again. And now, in the next couple of years, we are going to open all the interconnection to repair many of them, to consolidate all of them, and to replace about 15% of them, to be able to start again in 2015 at the design, close to the design energy of the accelerator. So the second component, the detector. So this is, for example, ATLAS. CMS is similar, a bit smaller, but not less challenging and less complex. So the two beams arrive from the left and the right, and they collide in the middle of the detector, and you see the structure of this apparatus. They are made of cylindrical concentric layers made of different materials, silicon, gas, liquid argon, scintillator, etc., closed at the two ends by two end cap. So look at the size of this object. It's 45 meters long, 25 meter high, so ATLAS is more or less half Notre Dame in Paris. You can also judge the scale by comparing with the size of two human beings, a man and a woman, because in ATLAS we promote equal opportunities, so we always put men and women. I hope you appreciate this. So why so big? So big because we need to measure with high precision and absorb very high energy particle produced in the energetic collision of these two beams. And so in order to measure with precision and absorb energetic particles, we need big volumes. So the size of the detector scale, with some low depending on the kind of detector, with the energy of the accelerator. At the same time, in every time the two beams collide, a few hundred to thousand particles are produced. And we want to measure, ideally, each one of these particles with a micrometric precision. 1 micron is 1 millionth of a meter. And in order to do so, especially in the region very close to the beam, at few centimeters from the beam line, where the density of this particle is the highest, we need a huge number of individual sensitive elements read out by its individual readout chain. So this object contains, in particular, concentrated close to the beam line, 100 million individual sensitive elements which produce individual signals. And this is a result. This is an example of a collision in the CMS detector. It's a real collision data registered by recorded by CMS. And so this is the collision point. And you can see by eye the signal, this little yellow dots released by a given particle, for instance, this one, in the various layers of the detector. This is an energy deposit, for instance, in the calorimeter. And you can see that by starting from these hits, we can reconstruct the trajectory of each one of these particles. So this is the kind of picture of the event that we are able to reconstruct. And then, of course, the next step, as I said, is to look at these events and interpret them and understand if this was the production of a new particle or a new phenomenon or what kind of interaction was at play in this specific collision. So these detectors can be seen as giant digital camera which take pictures of the collision, and then you develop your picture and many pixels in your camera, you develop your picture and you can look at what was produced. However, you should note that these cameras must be ultra-fast because the two beams interact 40 million times a second. So it's a very high pace. Not all of these collisions are recorded and stored because it would be impossible to analyze all this data, just a fraction, a few hundred per second. But nevertheless, the detector, at least some level of the detector response, must be able to take picture at this very intense pace. Also impressive is the size and the geographical spread of the physicists involved in these experiments. In ATLAS and CMS work something like 3,000 scientists each. In ATLAS, they come from 38 countries. I guess it's similar in CMS. This is, for instance, the ATLAS map. You can see countries like South Africa, Australia, China, South America, huge number of people from all over the world. Italy participate in ATLAS and CMS through 25 groups from INFN and Associated University for a total of almost 500 scientists, 450-500 scientists, of which a good third are young students. So actually, a common feature is that typically one third of the collaborations is made of students. The Italian groups have contributed, as I mentioned before, to the most of the components of the detectors, to the software and computing developments, to the physics, in particular the Higgs discovery, and now to the upgrade of the detectors to operate at a higher luminosity, higher intensity foreseen for the LHC. I'd like to show this picture, which shows the distribution of the age of the ATLAS population in blue for boys and in red for girls. As I used to say, I am in this bin and I will stay always in this first bin. I will not move from there. So you can see that actually what I was saying before, so 1,000 out of 3,000 physicists are students. And you can see, and if you include the young postdoc, then you see that most of the collaboration is below 30, 35. So most of the collaboration is young. And actually, the young people are those who, with their competence, enthusiasm, I must say, depth also, they are extremely deep, the young generation now, give driving force of these experiments. You can also note that women at the moment are at the level of 20%, But there is an increase in fraction in the younger generation, which I think is good. It shows that, of course, the details come also from history, but I think there are more and more young women starting activity in fundamental research. I think I will skip the computing and leave it to question to move to the physics itself. So I will give you a few additional numbers to impress you even more, but also to give you some other ideas of the challenges. So when the machine is full of protons, there are something like 100,000 billion, 10 to the 14 protons, 100,000 billion protons per beam. 10 to the 14 protons circulating in one direction and 10 to the 14 protons circulating in the other direction, traveling close to the speed of light, so 11,000 turns of the accelerator per second, interacting 40 million times per second, colliding 40 million times per second in ATLAS or in CMS or LHCb. At the collision point, the two beams are squeezed in order to increase the interaction collision probability, and the transfer size of the beam is less than 20 micron, so much less than the size of a human ear. I mentioned that DLHC is a bath of superfluid helium, so at 1.9 Kelvin, which makes DLHC the coldest place of universe, as we say, because the present temperature of the universe is 3 Kelvin, whereas DLHC is at 1.9 Kelvin. So it's a cool project, as we see. Also very important and very impressive is the energy stored in the beam. Why? Because in this beam we have 100,000 billion protons traveling at a kinetic energy close to the speed of light. So if you put the two things together, the number of protons and their speed, you get that the energy of the beam is 350 megajoule, which is an impressive amount of energy. On the web, I found something like this corresponds to a British aircraft carrier traveling at 12 knots. So, as I say, why it has to be British and cannot be another kind of aircraft carrier, this is not clear, but I'm just reporting what I saw. So, this beyond the joke, you can imagine what really that these beams have to be steered again with the precision of a few micron, because of course you don't want to lose 350 megajoule of beam on a superconducting magnet, because the superconducting magnet will not be happy to get 350 megajoule. So it's really extremely challenging, and the LHC is a very powerful instrumentation diagnostic system. The CMS experiments weighs more than the Tour Eiffel, so 13,000 tons, and has more iron than the Tour Eiffel in Paris. And in ATLAS we use 3,000 kilometers of cable, to bring the signals from the underground cavern to the control room where these data are stored. And I didn't say much about computing, so let me just tell you that every year, each one of the four experiments writes an amount of data corresponding to about 10 petabyte. Everyone knows what a petabyte is, but in case you wanted to write this 10 petabyte in normal DVDs, you will need a stack of 20 kilometers. So we will need four stacks of 20 kilometers, each one per experiment. So clearly the question is, why all this? So I try to summarize the reason in a very simple way in one of two slides. So the reason is the following. The elementary particles and their interactions are very well known today, thanks to 30, 40 years of very high-level, meticulous, and high-quality experimental work at CERN and in other accelerators all over the world, in particular in the US, both Chicago, Fermilab, or SLAC, and other laboratories all over the world. So the elementary particles observed so far and their interactions are quite well known. In addition, we have a theory, which is called standard model, and recently Professor Barbieri proposed to call it standard theory because it's really, really working extremely well. It's just more than a model. So this theory is very successful. All the particles predicted by the standard model have been discovered. The 16 particles that you see here, plus the last one, in July last year, so the Higgs boson. I will come back to the Higgs boson and its standard model interpretation later on. Not only all the particles produced by the standard model have been discovered, but all the predictions of the theory have been verified with a very high precision, meaning that the difference between what we measure and what the theory predicts agrees at the level of 10 to the minus 3, 10 to the minus 4, and within the error bar, which is experimental error bar, theoretical error bar, which are very small. To this theory, many Italian theorists and scientists have contributed, Fermi, of course, but then Maiani, Cabibbo, Professor Barbieri, and many others have given very fundamental contributions. The problem with the standard model is that it's clearly a correct theory because it describes the elementary particles in a correct way. It has been verified. However, it's not a complete theory. It's not able to answer, to address all the questions that we have today. So the first one in the list was the question about the origin of the particle masses, question that we can now start to tick off, because with the discovery of the Higgs boson, we think we know how particles get a mass. But there are many other. One is the nature of the universe dark matter. Everybody knows by now that we know essentially only 5% of the energy matter content of the universe. So only this means that only 5% is made of the matter that I described before, electron, quarks, atoms, chemical elements like we are made of. About 20-25% is made of a form of matter which has a composition we don't know. We call it dark matter, where dark, in some sense, indicates on one end our ignorance, but also that this matter does not interact directly with our instruments. We know it's there, in particular from the motion of the galaxies. So it's matter, but with none of the standard model particles, none of these particles observed so far and predicted by the standard model as the good feature to explain dark matter as it is observed by several experimental measurements. We don't understand why there is such a big asymmetry in the universe between matter and antimatter. We don't know, for instance, if the elementary forces unify at very high energy. So the standard model is not really able to answer all the questions. So it cannot be the ultimate theory of particle physics. There must be physics beyond the standard model able to address this question, although the standard model is, of course, correct. So it's a theory valid at the energies explored so far, and a theory which is a part of a more general theory. So the LHC has been conceived and built to address these and other questions and try to answer them, or at least give partial or full or at least partial answers. So the adventure started in March 2010 when first proton beams with unprecedented energy started to circulate in the accelerator. And since then, we have made very big progress. The three fundamental elements, accelerator, detector, and computing, have been performing very well beyond expectations. Both experiments, ATLAS and CMS, have recorded a huge amount of data. Typically, 5 billion collisions have been recorded by each one of the two main experiments, not to mention the two other experiments, LHCb and ALICE. We have observed the known particles of the standard model, the W boson, the Z boson, the top quark, etc., and we have measured them in a new energy regime, much larger, factor of 4 larger than the previous accelerator, and the standard model works very well at high energy. And also, we have been looking for hints for physics beyond the standard model, physics which could allow us address the questions I mentioned before. Unfortunately, we didn't find any sign of physics, of clear physics beyond the standard model. But most importantly, in July 2012, the two big experiments, ATLAS and CMS, reported the discovery of a new particle, which at that time we called Higgs-like because it resembled very much to the Higgs bosons, but we didn't have at that time much information to conclude, but today I will show you that with the data recorded until then, we have 3 times more data than we had in July 2012 today, we can say, tell with some confidence that this particle is a Higgs boson. It has a mass which corresponds to 130 times the proton times the proton mass. So today, as our director general, the CERN director general say, we can drop the like from Higgs like, not because we don't like it, but because we think it's a real Higgs boson. So why is this particle so important? So I would like to ask again my colleagues physicists to fall asleep for about 2 minutes while I go through this absolutely non-rigorous discussion. So the problem is the following. We didn't know until the 4th of July, although we had some ideas, we didn't know why some particles are massive, whereas other particle, like the photon, are just pure energy. So the photon has no mass. It's just pure energy. The photon is the particle which, at the microscopic level, in quantum mechanics, is responsible for transmitting the electromagnetic force between two electrons, something to which we are clearly used in our day-by-day life, of course, at the macroscopic level. There are other interactions, for instance, between electrons or quarks. One example is the weak force. The weak force is responsible for radioactive decays, is responsible for the thermonuclear reactions in the sun, and this force, pretty much like the photon transmit the electromagnetic force, the weak force is transmitted through the exchange of two particles called W and Z bosons. These particles are massive. They have a mass which is 100 times the mass of the proton. They are also famous because they were discovered at CERN at the beginning of the 80s, and they gave the Nobel Prize to Carlo Rubbia. So we don't understand. We didn't understand why some forces, like the electromagnetic force, is transmitted by a massless particle, whereas other forces, which are very similar for other reasons to the electromagnetic force, are transmitted by massive particles. The most massive elementary particle, elementary means, again, which cannot be cut into smaller pieces, that we have observed is one of the quarks. It's called top quark. It was discovered at the Tevatron Collider in 1995. It has a mass comparable to that of a gold atom. The electron has a mass which is 350 times smaller than the mass of the top quark. Why? This was not clear. In the original theory, in the standard model, the original standard model theory, all particles are massless. They are just pure energy, which, of course, contradict also the experimental evidence. The electron has a mass, though tiny. The W and Z particles have a mass. At the beginning of the 60s, a group of theorists, among which Scottish theorist Peter Higgs, introduced a mechanism which was called Higgs mechanism, although he received contribution from many others. I would like to mention in particular Robert Braut, who passed away, and François Englert, which allowed some particles, well, the photon, to remain massless and other particles to acquire a mass. And this is due to the Higgs field. In physics, you call field something that you can imagine a kind of medium which permeates the vacuum. In physics, the vacuum is not empty, and the Higgs field permeates the vacuum, say. In this room is full of the Higgs field, otherwise the electrons will not be massive. Okay. So this theorist introduced concept of Higgs field. So how does it work? I will try to explain it in a very, very simple way. So again, please, Ricardo, if you can just have a walk. And So at the beginning of the universe, just after the Big Bang, all particles were massless. They were just pure energy. So they were traveling at the speed of light. And imagine that at that moment, the universe is permeated by a medium, which we call a field in physics, okay? And that this medium is transparent, is there, but is not visible. So the elementary particles do not see it. The temperature goes down, because after the big explosion, the temperature goes down. And at some point, and this point is 10 to the minus 11 seconds after the Big Bang, okay, the temperature goes low enough that this medium goes through a transition phase. A transition phase is a complicated way in physics to indicate, for instance, when water becomes ice, when a medium goes from a state to another one, from liquid or gas to liquid, from liquid to solid. So imagine that at this temperature, this transparent medium becomes something more consistent than just something transparent. Becomes, for instance, what I like to call it, a kind of jam or marmalade, okay? At that point, the particles start to see that something has changed. There is now some consistent medium in the universe. Uh-oh. Now, imagine that the particles are little balls, okay? And imagine that if the surface of this ball is very smooth, liscia, as we'll say in Italian, then the particles go through this marmalade without even see it. And this is the photon. It remains massless. For him, nothing has changed. For him or her, I don't know if the photon is a woman or a lady or a gentleman. But anyway, here it remains massless. Imagine that other particles have a much rougher surface. So a rough surface, if you have a rough surface, the particles going through this marmalade or jam sticks some of this marmalade, becomes fatter, and it is slowed down. So this is the X mechanism, if you want. So if you want, let me tell it also in a more rigorous way so that my colleagues now see that at least I know something in physics. Assuming that it's the with the temperature, it's the X field which assumes, gets a vacuum expectation value which is not zero, and this produces an interaction term between the X field and the particle which gives masses to the particle set. Okay, beautiful, very nice. Actually, very clever mechanism, because nobody since the beginning of the 60s has been able to produce a better explanation on how the elementary particles can get a mass. This is the only mechanism, well, there are other explanations, but this is the one which has been mostly followed. The problem is that this mechanism predicted as a consequence of the Higgs field, the existence of a particle associated to this field, the famous Higgs boson, which had been looked for 30, 40 years at accelerator all over the world, but had not been found before. Although the Tevatron collider had more or less at the same time as the LHC some evidence, it was not really an evidence large enough to claim a discovery. But then, this particle was found at the LHC last year. So this question may look as a completely theoretical question of little impact on our life. However, this is not the case, because a world without Higgs, well, will not exist. Atoms stick together because the electron has a mass. We are what we are, and the universe is what it is, because there is a Higgs mechanism, a Higgs boson, or something which has this kind of the type of function. Now we know that it's the Higgs mechanism. Note also that even if the masses of the elementary particle were just tiny different from what they are, still the world would not exist. If the mass of the quarks were not exactly what they are, the proton may decay. If the proton may decays, there is no hydrogen atom, there is no chemistry, there is no chemical element, there is no universe, there is no mankind. So the universe would not exist or would be completely different. So we are what we are because the elementary particles have exactly the masses they are, except that until the 4th of July we had some ideas, this was the idea, but the idea was not verified experimentally, and now it has been verified. So what did we observe? The theory predicted that the Higgs bosons, once produced, decay immediately, so disintegrate itself immediately into other known particles. I take the example of the photons, because photons are the quantum, the components of the light, the constituents of light are common to everyday life. So the Higgs boson can decay into two photons. So ATLAS and CMS have taken their billions of collision, recorded collision, and have looked for events containing two photons. Then you look for, so for instance, in CMS, an event containing two photons, this one you see here, the two beams in yellow, colliding in the center of the detector, several particles coming out, and then also two photons indicated by these two green bar, which represent, show the energy deposited in the calorimeter. So we look at, we take these events, we look at the spectrum of the events, and this is what ATLAS observed, and on top of a smoothly falling spectrum, as you expect from a background, if you have the production of new particles, you expect a peak. You expect a narrow line, okay, at the location of the mass of the new particle. And this is what ATLAS today observed with the full data sample recorded over the last years. You can see by eye that there is a bump, a resonance, as it's called in physics, here, which is even more evident if you subtract the continuum background. You see here a very nice peak. The probability today that this peak comes from a fluctuation of the background is very small, it's 10 to the minus 13, so it's extremely tiny. The Higgs boson can also decay into leptons, among which electrons and their heavier counterpart, muons. So this is a beautiful event recorded by CMS. In this collision, two electrons have been produced, which are recorded in part of the detector, measured with part of the detector called calorimeter, and two muons, which are the fundamental constituent of the cosmic rays on Earth, are detected by their muon chambers. And this again, if you look at the spectrum of the events with four leptons, you see that the data point in black reproduce very well the background of other phenomena in blue, except in this region, again, around 130 times the mass of the proton, where there is an excess of events, a clear peak, which is in agreement with the signal expected from a Higgs boson. Finding this particle was not easy because, for instance, one Higgs decaying into four electrons is produced every 10 to the 13 proton-proton collision, 10,000 billions of proton-proton collision. So it has required a lot of ingenuity, a lot of meticulous experimental work, a lot of ingenuity in analysis techniques in order to be able to extract such a tiny signal from the huge amount of background. And I would like to stress again that many of the ideas and a large part of the work was done by young people, young students and postdocs. Just a number, in case you wondered, as of today, and this will remain the same in the next couple of years because we are not going to take data, new data until 2015, each experiment has about 600 Higgs bosons in our data sample. Okay, so these two pictures shows you the birth and evolution of a signal in here for CMS in the four lepton decay mode, and here for ATLAS in another channel, two leptons and two neutrinos. The black points show the data. In the blue, you can see the background coming from other processes, and you can see that the data are well above the background. And in red, here and now here at the end also for ATLAS, the additional contribution from the expected Higgs signal. And you clearly see CMS started again, but anyway. So you see here the data point, the background from other processes, and in also ATLAS now starting. Okay, fine. Anyway, so you have seen that the data are in excess compared to the background and are in good agreement when you add the Higgs signal. So a couple of questions and then I conclude. Is this a Higgs boson? Let's go back to our table of elementary particles. Until the 4th of July, the world of discovered elementary particles was made of 16 objects, these 16 objects here. These 16 objects can be divided into two main classes. This one in green are called matter particles. They're called matter particles because some of them, the up quark, the down quark, and the electron, are the fundamental constituent of the atom. And then there is a second class of particles, the photon, the W and Z bosons, and the gluon, which are called force carriers, because as I mentioned before, These particles are responsible of transmitting the elementary forces between elementary particles. So the photon transmits the electromagnetic force, the W and the Z boson, the weak force, and the gluon, the strong force. The X boson is neither, according to the theory, is neither a matter particle nor a force carrier. It's a completely different particle. It's special. It's another qualitatively completely different particle. It's a very special particle, and actually, if you wanted to add this 17th particle to this list, we should put it in a separate box. Okay. What are the fingerprints of the Higgs boson? So what distinguishes the Higgs boson from the other particles? First of all, to accomplish its job, that is providing mass, the Higgs mechanism is there to give masses to the elementary particle. It has to couple with particles, in particular with to the W and Z bosons, in a way proportional to the masses of the particle themselves. So ATLAS and CMS have started to measure the properties of the Higgs boson. In July, we discovered it, and since then, the accent, the emphasis has shifted toward measuring the properties of this particle with more data in order to understand its nature. And I show you a nice result of CMS, which has measured the way the Higgs boson couples to the elementary particles, and you can see here that, indeed, the coupling is proportional to mass over a quite large range of masses. The top quark has a mass of 175 GeV. The tau lepton has a mass which is a factor of 100 smaller. So you see that indeed this particle has these features of coupling itself to the elementary particle in a way proportional to mass. The second feature of the Higgs boson is that it's a spin zero particle, or as you say it in physics, in fundamental physics, is a scalar. So the spin is a complicated concept. I don't want to go into many details, but it's a quantum number, like you can imagine the color of the eyes, a quantum number characterizing the particles in general, elementary also non-elementary particles. It's a mechanical feature related, can be associated with kind of internal rotational motion of a particle. The matter particles, I said that there are two kinds of particles before the discovery of the Higgs boson, matter particles and force carrier. Matter particles have spin 1/2. The spin is quantized in quantum mechanics. Spin 1/2, take it as granted that we don't have the time to go into details. The force carriers, photon W and Z, have spin 1. The Higgs boson is predicted to have spin 0. So that's also why it's completely different compared to the other particles. So can we measure the spin of this new particle? We did so. And the spin can be measured by looking at the angular distribution space in the final states of the decay product. So, for instance, the Higgs decays into two photons. You look at the angular distribution of the photons in your detector, and this distribution keeps memory of the spin of the mother the particle. So, what we did was to look at what will be the expectation for particle of spin 0, so the Higgs boson, and this particle of different spin, spin 2 is a possibility, and then we have compared our data with the expectation. This is what ATLAS observed. So this will be the expectation, after fitting the data in some kind of likelihood units, of in red for a spin 2 particle. This will be the expectation for a spin 0 particle, so for the Higgs boson in the standard model, and this is what ATLAS measured. So clearly, the data favor the spin zero hypothesis, rejecting with a very high confidence level the spin two, actually larger than 99.9 confidence level. So this is a very important result. It's a particle which is a completely new particle, as I said. It's not a matter particle, it's not a force carrier, so it's a particle which has the property of coupling proportionally to mass. It's a particle which has a completely different spin zero. This observation is very important because if the Higgs boson is an elementary particle, which we think, based on what we have measured so far, it's an elementary particle, it's the first elementary particle with spin zero. There are composite particles like the pion who have spin zero, but this will be the first elementary particle with spin zero. This means the associated field is a scalar field. The Higgs field is a scalar field. And this also has consequences for the universe evolution, because perhaps you know that the most fashionable cosmological theories today, most fashionable because also supported by a certain number of experimental observations, predict that at the beginning the universe went through a phase of very fast expansion called inflation. And this inflation was triggered by a scalar field called the inflaton. Now, we don't know if the Higgs boson is the scalar field which has triggered the inflation, perhaps not. However, the fact that we have demonstrated that in nature scalar field do exist, it's clearly, we didn't know if it was the case until 1 year ago, I think it's a very good step in this direction. So, three frequently asked questions, and then I conclude. So, one of the questions that people usually ask is this new particle the standard model Higgs boson? So, I think I've demonstrated to you that showing these two nice plots from ATLAS and CMS, that we have demonstrated that this new particle is a very special one, is of the class of the Higgs boson, because it has really spin zero and couples to the elementary particles, in particular to the W and Z boson as expected. Now, whether it is the standard model Higgs boson predicted by Peter Higgs and company, or a Higgs boson accomplishing the same task but belonging to a more general theory beyond the standard model, this we don't know, because our present measurements do not have enough sensitivity, meaning the experimental errors, uncertainties are too big to conclude. Of course, we would prefer that this object is an exotic object, because it means that we have discovered theory beyond the standard model. Second, is the task of DLHC over? Clearly the question is no, not only because we want to understand this new friend in all details, but also because, as I mentioned before, DLHC was built to address a huge number of questions, of which the origin of the particle masses was at the top of the list, was very important, but not the only one. Dark matter, matter-antimatter asymmetry, etc. So we will continue to work looking at data already recorded with the new data. And the last question is, will the Higgs boson change our day-by-day life? And my take on that is that it did already change our life. And the reason is that in order to find it, we had to develop so much technology in a huge number of domains at CERN and in the collaborating institutes and laboratories from all over the world that have been already transferred to society. I give you a couple of examples. There exist in the world today 30,000 accelerators worldwide, and more than half of them, 17,000, are relatively small compared to the LHC, but they are devoted to medical application, so cancer treatment, for instance. And they have been built based on the technologies developed in our field. Likewise, several devices used in medical imaging, for instance, scanners, etc., are based on the technologies developed at CERN or in similar collaborating laboratories and institutions. So, to conclude, at CERN and in particular with DLHC, we look to address answers about the fundamental constituent of matters, which of course give us also some indication about the structure and evolution of the universe. And by doing so, we have to, of course, to push the frontiers of technology, which of course goes also to the benefit of society. CERN is also, and these projects in general, this collaboration, this big collaboration, are a very stimulating environment to train young people and to bring nations together through science. Actually, in this big collaboration, people from countries which are not really entertaining a very romantic relationship work together in peace, animated by the same passion for science. The discovery of the Higgs boson is a very fundamental step in our understanding of the fundamental physics and in the structure and evolution of the universe. But I would like to mention two things before concluding. So first of all, I would like to stress that fundamental knowledge is the fuel of applied research and progress. Without ideas, sooner or later, the progress will stop. The electricity or lights, you know, is not just the evolution of the candle. It's a completely different concept going from the candle to not just an adiabatic evolution. It's required innovative concept. And if ideas at some point are not developed, sooner or later, the progress will stop. And the country which is forced to buy fundamental knowledge from other countries is, I will say, on the path toward collapsing. Second, I have insisted on the applications of fundamental research. However, we should really also stress that knowledge, like art, is among the highest expression of human being, which distinguish us from animals. And so they really deserve being supported. I mean, are we going to say that we don't support art because it's not useful for what I'm going to eat tomorrow? Supporting them, it's really fundamental, very important, because otherwise this means really, in some sense, distorting the real nature of mankind. Thank you, Gigi.
Thank you, Fabiola. Time for questions.
Costas.
The coupling to the top quarks, the Higgs is not heavy enough to decay to two top quarks. Is this through the
bottom? It's indirect, yes. Yes. So, okay, Costas is asking, of course, a technical question of an expert. So, we did not observe the Higgs decay into top quarks. What we observe is the Higgs production, and the Higgs production actually occurs mainly through a process where a gluon from a proton interacts with a gluon from the other proton. I told you that inside the protons we have quarks which stick together thanks to gluons, which are the carriers of the strong force. So these two gluons interact and produce a Higgs boson through a loop of top quarks. So our measurement of the couplings of the Higgs to the top quark that I show in this graph of proportionality is indirectly through this loop. So we have to assume that this loop is dominated by top quarks, but actually what we measure in terms of production rate is very much in agreement with what is predicted by theory.
You mentioned dark matter as one of the possible future contribution of LHC. So what are the prospects there, and also in terms of the cosmological relevance of the dark matter particle that you possibly...
Yeah, so what are the prospects? So clearly there are various... dark matter can be made of different things. Of course, one of the... my preferred, and I'm not the only one in this room, I think, interpretation of dark matter would be that one of WIMP, weakly interacting massive particles, okay? So the measurement made of dark matter based on various observations, the motion of galaxies and other, show that indeed a weakly interacting particle, this is why we don't observe it, don't see it, a weakly interacting particle, massive, a few hundred GeV, will be an ideal candidate. Now, in the standard model, such a particle does not exist. A neutrino is not, is weakly interacting, but is not massively enough. And this dark matter must be cold dark matter, so no relativistic dark matter. So, of course, one very good candidate is provided by supersymmetry, which, as you know, is a very motivated theory, which would actually, by itself alone, be able to answer most of the questions that I put in the list before, which, of course, Riccardo Barbieri is one of the fathers. And supersymmetry, I think, is very close to the heart of all of us, not only because it's a beautiful theory, with a very rich, very simple, and very elegant, with a rich phenomenology, which is good because it means that we observe many particles, we have a lot of things to look at, but with very simple theoretical grounds and very elegant, would allow to address many of these questions, dark matter, unification of the odd forces, and many stability of the Higgs mass, because I don't want to go into detail, so hierarchy problem. But unfortunately, we don't have evidence for supersymmetry as yet. Doesn't mean that supersymmetry is not in our present data, because, of course, we have looked for it in the most obvious topologies, and we didn't find anything. But, you know, it could hide itself in some region of the parameter space that we still have to dig. But, of course, it's not that. It's like if it is it was hiding itself a bit. Now, we will start again to take data in 2 years from now at 14 TV, so there is really the hope that we can still observe supersymmetry. And in principle, we should be able to observe, you know, the heaviest, strong partners of the quark and gluons up to very high masses, say up to 1.5 to 2 TeV, and should be also able to detect the lowest part of the spectrum, the gejinos, which are important for dark matter. So we still hope for it, but okay. Not. Another interpretation of dark matter could be that it's made of axions, but for that, I think the LHC is not the best. Well, we could take all the LHC magnets and use them as axion detectors, but okay.
Okay. I have a question from a more social point of view,
yes.
Because I recently read an interview of yours shared by IEEE Women in Engineering Society. We saw the histogram of distribution of the ages and of the gender in the scientists in CERN. And while we would expect a fewer percentage of women scientists in the older ages, I don't see that in the ages of less than 25 years or less than 34 years, a more pro-equality of the gender of the scientists in CERN. What do you think this happens?
Yeah, it's increasing with decreasing age. Huh?
The derivative.
Yes, the derivative is okay. Now, yes, exactly. So, yeah. So, I think we should be a bit. I think there is still some remnant of history, okay? So there is historical condition because which makes that for many years women have not been studying. Hard scientists like mathematics, physics, or doing research in that science. There are some social aspects, lack of infrastructure in some countries, which not really allow women to share their life between professional and private life. But I must say, we should not overdo it. It's important to keep an eye and to help women to get the same opportunities as men. But I will not overemphasize it in the sense that, for instance, in our field, if you take our experiments, and I can ask other women here working in Chiara and other working in Atlas or in CMS, you know, this collaboration are so, there is no, I don't think there is this any kind of intellectual discriminations. I don't think so. I didn't suffer from it. And I must say that this collaboration are so so rich in terms of people from all over the world, you know, very senior and very famous scientists, close to Nobel Prizes, working with very young students, people from all kinds of traditions, young and more senior, etc. That being men, the gender is not really an issue. I must say that in Atlas, I've been coordinating an experiment, and I was appointed spokespersons or coordinators essentially of the experiment in 2008 by democratically by the 3,000 physicists of the experiment, which are mainly male. So, and this is the demonstration that there is no discrimination, and it was a very delicate moment when the experiment was starting to take data. In ATLAS, we have a similar, likewise in CMS, I'm not the only example, we have women who are project leaders of part, important part of the detector, who are conveners of physics group, who are collaboration board chair. So I think the mentality is extremely, I don't see any bias coming from the mentality. What we are still a bit suffering, quote unquote, is history, and also clearly infrastructure sometimes, which makes life of women doesn't allow them to devote all the time they would like to research. But we have many examples of women who have a very important role, like Chiara, who have little children. So I think it's good to pay attention to it, but we should not really, overstressing it.
Fabiola is always very generous. So, Fabiola, since there are a lot of students, I would like that you, sometimes this huge number of people collaborating together scares a bit the students, because normally, and I think it's a good wish, they would like to feel central. And sometimes they think, I guess, that such a huge collaboration makes it difficult. So can you comment a bit on how you see this thing?
Yeah, so it's a very relevant question that Chiara asked. So clearly, you can imagine, you can compare what is an activity of a young student in different experiments. So suppose that we take a tabletop experiment, a small experiment which really fits on this table, to this table. And there are some experiments in condensed matter or a small experiment, a student, which is run by a team of 20 people, a student knows perhaps everything, or almost everything of this experiment from A to Z, from the theory all the way up to the final result. And this is very nice, an advantage. Then we take an experiment as ATLAS. Of course, it's not tabletop, it's much bigger. But what are the advantages? First of all, the work of a student, of a young person, is not made with 3,000, 290 other people. It's made in a smaller team, 10, 20 people, working on a specific problem and being the expert of this problem. Of course, the student does not know the experiment in all the details. But through meetings, through discussion with other people, in an experiment like ATLAS and CMS, a young person is exposed to a huge number of technologies and a huge number of physics. If you do a tabletop experiment, you know very well one or two technologies, and you know very well that kind of physics. You master it completely. You are perhaps the world expert. But you don't know much about other physics when you are, or other technologies. When you are in an experiment like ATLAS or CMS, you may be working on the CMS crystal calorimeter, but then you will go to a CMS meeting and you hear the people talking about pixel, about silicon, about muon. And so in some sense, this opens your mind. And so at the end, the culture that you get in this big experiment is extremely enriching, extremely large. Also take into account also that in particle physics today, almost say 80% of the particle physicists, experimental particle physicists, are involved in the big LHC experiments, say ATLAS and CMS, of course there are others. So when a student gives a talk in an ATLAS and CMS meeting, and we know very well that we all make in ATLAS and CMS efforts to give visibility to the young people, allowing them to speak at conferences and in big meetings, is like talking to a big international conference, to the expert of the field. So they are exposed to the expert of the field. So it's also very important for their career. They get job opportunities. Also, in this big collaboration, they are confronted with peers from all over the world. The confrontation is not just with the people in your small lab, but it's with the people, with peers people of your age and peers from all over the world, which is also very good because not just a local. So there are clearly advantages and disadvantages, but working in this experiment, I must say our young people in Atlas and CMS, I think they are all super enthusiastic, all super motivated and full of energy. We make, as you know, in Atlas and also in CMS, a lot of efforts. I think I showed even to Ricardo a few days ago in Paris a plot where I showed the speakers that Atlas sent to the most important conference in the field in 2010. The most important conference took place in July in Paris. It's called ICEP. And 2010 was a very special year because at that conference we presented for the first time results from Atlas and CMS based on collision. There were two plenary talks about Atlas and CMS, which were given by the spokesperson by request by the CERN Director General, and all the other talks given in the important parallel session in Atlas. I can show you 20 speakers. They are all young people. So the collaboration pushes the youngest person to go in front of the scientific community and to present results. We have many young people, conveners of physics group, etc. So I cannot say that it's ideal in one sense, but I will not overstress that small experiment is really much better. There are advantages in both cases.
I find it useful to make a physics comment to see whether you agree or not. You said that in fact is an important comment that you have tested actually the standard model at the level often of 10 to the minus 3, 10 to the minus 4, and we know that is very important. I would, however, notice that when one goes to the issue of the communication between the different families, right, the different generations, there, if I had to quote a number to describe the level of accuracy, it would be more at the level of 10-20%, and I think that to insist there is very important as a way to perhaps understand something more beyond the standard model.
They were problem. Yes, absolutely, I agree. Yeah.
Are there other questions or comments? So if not, we can thank Fabiola again.
Thanks to you.
We are in the next room.
Ciao carissimo, ci vediamo via nel cielo.